So last time I talked about regenerative medicine, I was introduced with the idea that maybe regenerative medicine is a threat. And I'm trying to figure out, I mean, in a sense, the future is always a threat to the status quo. But I suppose what was meant by that is that people are not quite sure, once we totally embrace regenerative medicine, what will be the status of pharma, of funding, of meetings, of all the sorts of general things that we're kind of familiar with today. So how do you see that going? I mean, in the long range future, you can imagine a point where we're not using money anymore, where, you know, all of human society is changed. And so the question of, you know, the sale of immunosuppressives at that point seems kind of not like a rational question. But if we presume that things are going to proceed more quickly than that, so that we're dealing with not very many years hence, and therefore a society similar to what we have now, if regenerative medicine really takes off, if we are able to provide organs to everybody that needs them, say 1.2 million people a year, how do you see that working structurally? And is it going to be a threat to the way of life of pharmaceutical companies, many physicians today, or is it something totally benign and positive? I myself see it, but I'm sure I have a bias, as something totally benign and positive. But how will that then work?
No, I'm not sure. I don't think it's a threat in any possible way. You know, it's regenerative medicine, I think, is potentially helping people that we currently cannot help very well.
Yes.
And in that sense, I think in no way it's a threat, but even for the most greedy pharmaceutical company, you know, dealing with end-stage renal disease or heart or kidney or liver or lung failure is, I don't know, you know, having a better solution will probably be more lucrative in some ways than, mm-hmm. than what we have right now. So, yeah, I don't think regenerative medicine is a threat. I don't see it that way. It's a potentially disruptive technology for
yes.
many possible diseases. You know, if you think of renal transplantation versus dialysis, or heart transplantation versus heart failure, that while the technology is very disruptive, really from a public health perspective, it's not that disruptive because there's just a glass ceiling to it no matter what.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we figure out how to make personalized organs possible, I think then we have something that could potentially change the care of these patients. And in that sense, it is more of a disruptive technology, I think.
Yeah. So here is what I was thinking would be my answer if some high official from a pharma company asked me this. That there are problems in regenerative medicine now, like the fact that organs clot and that we can't not pavement 100% of the endothelial surface, that are common to all organs and are really important. And it's possible that there could be a pharmaceutical solution to that. That would then be an exciting new drug. If we can somehow make these dumb endothelial cells that sort of settle and cover 80% of the surface that we're trying to cover, and if there was a drug that would magically make them smart so that they would seek out every single denuded area and cover it all, then I think there's substantial money to be made. And so these companies would make a profit on that. They could provide a little bit of support to medical meetings and medical societies, and sort of life goes on. And that's just one of many areas where regenerative medicine at the moment needs something it doesn't have. I mean, it's sort of almost there, but not quite. And we don't know quite what the solution is. And so it seems to me there's an entrepreneurial or for-profit opportunity in many areas here. Even the idea of having cells end up in the right places or the right quantity of cells, or having cells not die, having cells be adequately oxygenated so that we don't end up with tracheas that crump because the important parts of it are not receiving sufficient blood supply and so on. And I think it could be structured in a way that it's not just a single purchase of a drug at one point and nothing afterwards, that probably there would be something that's analogous to chronic immunosuppressive therapy. We don't know quite what it will be, but this is an area with still many unanswered questions, and the pharma industry is probably going to end up being a part of the solution to some of the questions that we haven't entirely solved yet. So right. is that how you see it?
That's an interesting approach. Or an interesting pitch in some ways.
I'm not sure I entirely believe it, but I wonder whether you do. So
no, sure. I mean, if you look at budgets of stem cell differentiation or research budgets, how much it costs you to differentiate certain cells into certain phenotypes, right? That there must be a business behind that. Of course, it's a small business at this point. But sure, if this would find ever its way into broader clinical application, I think there must be a buck to be made for the pharmaceutical industry. I think my impression at this stage is that everybody's quite risk averse, and that a lot of the therapeutics were seen as cell-based therapeutics, not necessarily guiding cell fate therapeutics.
Mm-hmm.
And
right.
And a lot of the cell-based therapeutics, I think, to a side of MSCs, I think under-delivered a little bit in some ways. And my impression at least is that big pharma might not be seeing what you saw yet.
Yes.
But certainly, I think it's an excellent point that we're opening a new book. It's like saying, Siemens is not interested in x-rays, and then you look at them 80 years later and they make their business selling CT scans, right?
Yeah.
When there's a new technology, it's somewhat impossible for anybody to predict, and the one who sets the right bet on the right opportunity, of course, is the one who makes it. But at the time, it might not be obvious where the place for them would be in this field. So I think it's a very interesting thought.
Yeah, I mean, if you think of the bioreactor and the bioreactor environment, and if you think of the 1.2 million people per year who need organs, so if you put those two facts together, there's a business to be made making the optimal bioreactor for various organs, and then distributing the consumables to be used in it, and they're probably in many other. It's not just a matter of keeping pharma going; they have other things to keep them going, but also starting brand new businesses that probably don't exist yet, like. Individual researchers are probably patching things together that in the long run, when we scale this up, it will make sense to have companies doing what the individual researcher staffs are doing now.
Right.
So, it seems to me like a very positive world. How did you feel when you ended up with a video where the link to that video is solving the organ shortage problem? I ask that because I'm planning to go to the cutting edge of transplantation meeting in February, and one of my fellows is here who's going with me, And we feel we're kind of disruptive because we're going to talk about regenerative medicine, whereas everybody else is probably going to talk about, you know, getting more people to consent for donation and, you know, all this sort of old-fashioned thing. Much of the meeting, I expect, will be similar to a meeting you could have put together in the 60s or the 70s.
About transplantation.
Yes, yes. Right. That's right. But still, there's this force, and I'm glad I'm not the only one doing it, kind of disrupting those meetings by talking about a future, maybe 10 to 15 years hence, where regenerative medicine will completely solve this. So how do you think of that? I mean, if you go beyond the US and Canada and Western Europe and so on, does it seem to you doable to really make this a worldwide enterprise? Presumably, new therapies, new things, even, you know, TVs and radios and stuff were very expensive in the beginning. So probably as this scales up in the beginning, it will be an opportunity only for well-funded people or programs in the first world. But do you see eventually it being possible to basically disseminate this to every human being who actually needs an organ? Or do you think that's pie in the sky and will probably never ever happen?
No, I think that's a good question. I'm always a little bit surprised by that question. And because as a physician, as a scientist, of course, you really have the motivation to develop something that's applicable and can be delivered to everybody. Right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I mean, in all reality, it took over 100 years to get antibiotics to everybody, and not everybody has antibiotics.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. And so I think to put the burden, is this applicable to everybody, into that development phase is simply too early. Because, mm-hmm. I mean, we have trouble distributing the simplest technologies in the world, like an eye exam, to everybody.
Right.
So I think the issue of distribution is not in the solution, but is in the fact that we're just not very good at distributing no matter what. In the end, the care of let's say, COPD, right, costs about $80 billion, moderate to severe COPD in the United States.
Right.
And the care and the majority of patients suffering from moderate to severe COPD don't live in the Western world, but in the, if you will, the underdeveloped world.
Mm-hmm.
And so the healthcare burden in these countries of by end organ failure as age increases is tremendous, is completely unmet. So I think that no matter what we develop, if we can somehow distribute it, it would be applicable anywhere. I mean, as everything that starts out to be extremely complicated turns out to be not so complicated once it's further developed and established and commercialized, like you said. I mean, dialysis care, right?
Yes.
If you look at how expensive it is to take care of a dialysis patient, even in the States, what is it, $80,000 a year? And what's the mortality? 20 to 25% per year. So that cost is frequently hard to cover probably in many places, yet, you know, getting somebody off dialysis would probably save a lot of money in this sense. So as much as this sounds like a pie in the sky idea, I think that I think regenerative medicine has the potential, since you're creating something that is potentially self-sustaining,
mm-hmm. right?
You're creating a graft, yeah. or a therapy that you can implant and walk away from potentially, you know, that is the big difference to, let's say, forearm transplant or an implanted artificial heart, like an LVAD, right, where you need a highly sophisticated team, a highly sophisticated infrastructure, 24/7 available within a 2 hours range, otherwise you're not going to survive any complication. If you yes. generate an organ that is bioengineered from a patient's own cells, in theory that would be something, once fully integrated, it could run on its own, basically.
Mm-hmm.
So I think in that sense, it's a therapy that might be more or easier to distribute than or have lower barriers to distribution than other therapies that are currently evaluated.
Right. Let me just clarify what you're seeing at your end. So we have an audio-only connection with you with a fixed picture. It's a very fetching picture. It's perfectly fine. We don't need anything better than that. Are you seeing a moving video image of
No, I'm seeing a fixed picture of you. That's also a funny one. My picture must be from like 10 years ago or so when I set this up. Oh, yeah, perfect. I see my little picture up there.
Okay, so the you will be seeing video later because we're shooting video. So the students who ask you questions.
Can you see me now?
Okay, has enabled video except. Wow, yes, okay. And what about you? Are you seeing video on me yet?
No,
so what do I need to do? Let's see. So, all right, why is this? Let's see, start video. Okay, so now.
Yay!
Okay.
You got me up there on the big screen.
yeah. So, okay, well, maybe now that we've figured out all this multimedia stuff, we'll see if there are students who want to ask you questions. Now, our students are quite varied. So we have a theoretical physicist. Is that the correct way to characterize you, John? He's somewhat older than me. His age is unknown to me, but he's seen a lot of life.
So, 1 year younger.
1 year younger. Okay, he's actually 1 year younger than me. Okay, yeah. And then we have some very youthful students, and we have a regenerative medicine pathology fellow, just started in that role. John, you look brave enough. Do you want to come and pose some questions?
Oh, wow. Sure.
Yeah, okay, we'll come and stand here and, yeah. So I think for our recording, I'm just going to stand close to you so that my mic still catches what you're saying. Well, and there you can see your image.
Hi. My question is this, what's going on is fascinating. How soon do you think this is going to take root and be a viable thing that you can actually transplant into a person? Any idea at all?
I think it's tough to put a year out or a number of years out there, because it's now that we're, you find this video 10 years later and you said it's 10 years it's going to happen, and so it didn't happen. And it's amazing how much time flies. It took us a long time to, I think, establish interest in this and actually convince the community that this is something worthwhile pursuing. And so, since my first publication on heart decellularization, which was, I think, 2008, when we started thinking about it, it was 2005, 2004, 2005, then 2008 publication. So it's already 10 years that it took. It's amazing how much time flies. What I'm really excited about is that the transplant community has developed such an interest in it, because that's a community that has been traditionally aggressive about trying to translate therapies into clinical application. And so, my hope is that within the next 10 years, we'll be able to transplant something that functions at a higher level than just two-dimensional tissue. Now, which organ that's going to be is hard to predict. And like Kim had mentioned, there's a couple of topics that we work on that are common to all of these organs, like vasculature, for example. And so, so I think once we solve these and get people from more and more disciplines involved in this research, the time will accelerate. I mean, it all depends really on it all depends, of course, on the amount of brains that work on it, but it also depends on funding in many instances, right? Is this something that's too high risk, or is this something that six developmental biologists can put their career on? And I think that's what we're currently struggling with, that we need this brain power, but it's tough to tell somebody to base 6 years of their career on this if from an NIH perspective, for example, this is seen as way too high risk.
Now, you've got these problems growing a kidney, for example. I think you were talking about epithelial cells being in the wrong places, or not enough of them. Is that, and there's clotting,
right.
There's clotting, is that the problem?
Right, right.
Is that the major issue now?
There are many challenges.
Yeah, many challenges. Yeah.
With epithelial organs, that's exactly what we see, that it's hard to get the right cells in the right place, of course. And it's also, the question is, how many different cell phenotypes do you really need? Can you get away with a smaller number of different phenotypes in order to achieve sufficient function for transplantation, sufficient function for somebody to, let's say, come off hemodialysis or come out of respiratory failure, come off oxygen? So the placement of cells, I think what's really interesting about this right now is that what we're really trying to do is recapitulate morphogenesis or organogenesis on an adult matrix backbone, right, to accelerate it. During development, when we develop from an embryo through embryogenesis, structure formation, and then fetal period and postnatally, it takes 15 years to grow a human-sized kidney or 12 years or human-sized lung, let's say. And so we don't have that time with these patients. And so what we're currently trying to do is bridge that significant gap between using immature cells of an earlier developmental stage, but then accelerating that process of structure formation on the backbone of an adult matrix to accelerate the process.
Yeah. Did you have a question? No? Yeah.
You can ask another.
Well, there are so many things that would be likely to know. I was, for example, wondering what kind of a vacuum you have to put on this thing that is sufficient but not excessive, actually in terms of atmospheric pressure.
Oh, it was very low vacuum.
Yeah,
right. We
really
use
small.
A spectrum depending on which size of organ. We use somewhere between 5 and 30 centimeters water. So not uh-huh. a lot of vacuum.
So like right? 1% or something.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
So this is Khalud Ahmed. Oh, yeah.
Hi.
Hi there.
I'm the fellow, Dr. Solens. Maybe this is the first time you heard about fellowship in tissue engineering pathology, right?
No, that's awesome. That's perfect.
That's
funny. It's
new.
Funny because, you know, we looked at when you show your decellularized, recellularized organs to a pathologist, they're like, I don't know. Weird. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what we're fighting right now for it.
Right.
Like
right.
To have a discipline, proper discipline, so we can read all these organs.
Yeah, that's an interesting idea, right? Because
yeah,
you have to understand what cells went in and then have to decide what they became and eventually what pathology they developed, if any. It's interesting. Yeah, that's an interesting thought.
Yeah. So hope we'll get something with the near future. So my questions may be more specific about like the technique that you're using them.
Yeah.
So starting with the decellularizing process. So you're using kind of detergent, right? To kill the cells. So my question, is it selective for the cells, or it could also be harmful for the tissue by itself, I mean the extracellular matrix,
No, sure, yeah, absolutely, it's harmful. I mean, there's no question that basically it's a cocktail of detergents and different groups have used different detergents and we're still playing around. It's just that it's not a large research effort in our lab right now, but it's a simple system to lyse the cells and then remove as much DNA and intracellular protein as possible so that you start out with a relatively clean slate. But that process certainly damages the extracellular matrix to a certain extent and removes growth factors and removes, if not completely, but at least partially, removes more soluble extracellular matrix components.
Yeah.
You know, we're trying to analyze it and trying to understand better how much we remove and how much it matters and what we need to replace.
Yeah.
It turns out to be a complicated question, actually, because, you know, quantitative compositional analysis of extracellular matrix is a real headache.
Yeah.
You know, it's and we're collaborating with several labs trying to understand what the composition is and what do we lose and what remains. And then what's more complicated about it is even that we don't know what matters, right? We know, one thing we know is that the basement membrane of vasculature is preserved. So if you control perfusion pressure during your decellularization process, mm-hmm. you don't end up with something that's destroyed. But really, do endothelial cells or endothelial progenitor cells or parasites see what they need to see on this? I mean, vascular cells seem to see what they need to see on this. So is the niche preserved in some ways?
Yes.
It's hard to determine.
Yeah, so this is also my concern about it. The microvasculature is still there, like the vessels are there. That's what we really need to prevent the hypoxia later on, right?
So. Right, exactly. Yeah, so I mean, that's one thing we know is that the basement membrane throughout the organ is preserved. It's difficult to perfuse, of course, because
yeah.
you end up with an acellular basement membrane with no barrier function.
Yeah.
So any sort of crystalloid-based solution diffuses out very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
But if you do pressure control perfusion decellularization, you end up with something that is intact, or basement membrane that is intact.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Another question about the, I've been reading once that extracellular matrix proteins can also provide signals to the immune cells. So, did you encounter any rejection or did you ever transplant these organs and did you see any kind of rejection because of these signals from the extracellular proteins?
Yeah, I think that, so I wonder if we can think of it as rejection. I mean, there's a, in biomesh transplantation, or immune response, or
yeah.
well, in biomesh transplantation, there's a lot of immune response, or there's a remodeling, an M2 heavy remodeling response, I think that's frequently quoted, right? The Steve
mm-hmm.
Badlake has looked into, and his group in Pittsburgh have looked into the immune response to, I think, SIS and acellular non-cross-linked matrix products, and found that while there's no immune or allo response to them or xeno response, that
mm-hmm.
there's a macrophage-heavy remodeling response that can be, I think in the case of organs, can be quite destructive.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's
one
of, yeah, no, and produces fibrosis, exactly, and not a, certainly doesn't create an inflamed organ regeneration or whatever, like you'd see, I don't know, an epithelial regeneration in lung or so. So I think the immune response, what we did is for one of our papers that came out a couple of days ago, we had to go through, so we decellularized hearts, human hearts,
mm-hmm.
and then, you know, one of the reviewers felt strongly about us characterizing the immune response to these, and so we implanted a decellularized and non-decellularized human heart tissue into the immunocompetent rats, and then mm-hmm. looked for panel-reactive antibodies. And the decellularized ones did not elicit an immune response to cell surface proteins. So I think cellular antigens are probably removed, but a naked collagen matrix is immunogenic in itself and will cause some sort of immune response that we'll have to control. It's going to be you who figures out.
It's all up to you now, Kalut.
Okay.
Yes, sure, absolutely. So, one more question about the sorry, I can't get.
Yeah?
Yeah? Can you hear me now? No.
So, are we frozen or something?
Yeah. Well, I don't know if you can hear us, but you can.
Yeah.
Sorry, we lost the connection.
No.
Yeah, so my question is about the stem cells that you use, the induced stem cells, right?
Yeah, many of our research use induced pluripotent stem cells now. That's right. What's the question?
So you're using them after genetically modifying them, right?
In our case, they're not permanently modified. So they're made by the Harald stem cell core here. Those are mRNA induced NPS cells, and now they are induced using a technique using a temporary expression of transcription factors.
Okay.
So the cells are not genetically modified, I think that people always say that, oh, they're not permanently changed, and so it's fine. I don't think necessarily that that makes them safe. You know, I mean, they're undifferentiated pluripotent stem cells, so with all the potential to become the wrong things.
Yeah, that's what I was also going to ask. Like, if they're genetically modified, even temporarily, like, can we face in the future some kind of new cancers, new type of change in the cells due to these modifications?
Yeah, interesting question. I mean, your concern, I think the major concern is that you develop teratocarcinomas or sarcomas, basically.
Yeah.
Germ cell tumors of some absolute weird phenotype, right?
Yeah.
Something that hasn't existed before.
Yeah.
Which I think that concern, I think, is real, absolutely. I mean, you know, we did several transplant experiments also long term, and when we for example repopulated rat decellularized lungs with undifferentiated cells. Now, of course, those are undifferentiated cells, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we saw teratoma formation in vivo,
mm-hmm.
which is makes sense, right? That's I think to be expected. When we see differentiated cells down the vascular lineages, we have not seen teratoma formation. That doesn't mean that it doesn't happen, right? That's but yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's going to be interesting to see. Also, to have somebody actually be able to then determine how tight is fate control in these cells in the scaffold or in the matrix after implant, let's say a year or 2 years down the road, right? Who knows how they respond to a potential oncogenic insult?
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah,
it was a pleasure talking with you. Thank you so much.
No, thanks for asking questions.
Joseph. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Joseph.
Hey, Joseph.
I'm fine. I watched the video. Thank you very much. And my question is regarding the cost benefits of this initiative. I would like to know, of course, the benefits given the current needs in terms of organs. The benefits are tremendous. However, I would like to focus on the cost. Think of this, whenever you go to a physician, usually you ask questions, does any member of your family suffer from this? Or whenever you go to the insurance guys, they also ask similar questions. This is my question. Have you thought about the size of the cost this initiative may end up causing to the profession of medicine itself or to other professions in terms of the genealogical negative effects? Do you get my question?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I struggle with this question sometimes, you know, because I think that's not really what I do. You know, my job is to find ways to keep people alive and get them better. And as much as, of course, you cannot blind yourself to the ethical implications of using up all the resources in the system, I think that that if you look at hemodialysis, for example, or any other life-extending therapies, it's in a difficult spot to put then a value on how much is it worth to save somebody's life, right, in the end. And at what stage in the game in their role in society, is it a reasonable investment, and how much is that investment? How much of that investment would be reasonable? So I think these are very difficult questions that that for now I see it sort of as my obligation to since I've seen sort of that light at the end of the tunnel, that there might be a way to fix end organ failure, which is both expensive and lethal, to pursue that pathway and by pursuing it, potentially coming up with something that's fundable and reasonable. You know, I think time will tell how much this actually will be. We really don't know, right? The fact is that, you know, transplantation, if you look at transplantation, transplantation is very expensive, and is expensive in many ways, right? Of course, immunosuppression, the donation, etc. So time will tell how expensive this will be, and if we are able to, like for now, for example, it costs us to give you some hard numbers.
Right.
I mean, in order to re-endothelialize a lobe of a lung, we need somewhere around 1 billion endothelial cells. And it's become rather feasible to do that in an experimental setting in the lab, you know, to grow these with reasonable investment of manpower and non-prohibitive cost. I mean, this is something that, let's say 5 years ago or so, would have been an insane experiment in terms of even making that many cells of that certain type and seeding them into an organ. And within a culture period of a week's time, we can engraft a lot of these cells onto a scaffold and make it potentially blood perfusible already. So compare that cost to the cost of an MRI. You know, we're talking similar ranges there. So it's not that prohibitive. We're not talking about something that costs millions and millions of dollars. Right? We're talking about something that already in the experimental setting now is something that is affordable. So I don't think, I hope that these therapies will not be as prohibitive as we think they are or will be.
For sure, given the importance, mechanism may always be put in place, maybe to subsidize, to help all the various components of society have access to it to some extent. But this problem of how much disorder or reorganization may cause to the profession, say profession of medicine, say insurance companies, it is something worth seeing into it.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. No, I agree.
And this does not replace the tremendous usefulness of having organs to fill the gap. Yeah.
Right. No, absolutely. I think it's interesting. It's true. I mean, you're looking, of course, I'm seeing all the difficulties in our research, right? This is far away from application. But of course, if you, let's say you have a solution to replace anybody's failing organ, anybody's failing kidney, anybody's failing heart and lung, there's going to be a long line. Right? It's not going to be easy to manage that well. So
that's the beauty of it.
That's right.
Thank you very much.
I have always felt that the costs here depend upon our starting assumptions. I mean, if we really think that we want to make this practical for every country and for every person who might need this therapy in every country, then we need to build in subsidies and, you know, economies of scale and so on. So it just becomes a major part of the system. It's the way a substantial number of human beings on the planet are kept alive with high quality of life. And it's sort of like Christmas. You don't like have to justify how many days or hours you spend on Christmas. It's just, you know, or you know, something else like that, right? So it shouldn't be something that we have to justify that's seen as sucking resources away from other things. It should just be a right for everybody. And if we start with that assumption, the only problem is that it can't be rolled out to everybody when it starts. So there's a sort of built-in, you know, elitism or unfairness that's bound to be there for the first few successful cases. You know, they are not going to be in, you know, Bangladesh or the Belgian Congo or something. They'll be in Canada or the U.S. or Western Europe.
You never know, right? I mean, the first heart transplant was done in South Africa.
Yes.
Yeah, it all depends on where something gets developed and implemented in the end.
Right. Yeah, but we often regard medicine as having natural costs for things, and in fact, the cost for things, that's a whole sort of biology of itself. How prices are put on things, and you can imagine that tissue engineering, regenerative medicine could be set up so that it's such a major focus of what everybody in medicine is doing that every effort is made to keep costs down and to roll this out to everybody. You can also imagine a horrible situation where it would be exactly the opposite. You know,
I think a lot of it is economy of scale, like you said, right?
Yeah.
If you were to order so many micrograms of activin A or a milligram of activin A for cell differentiation 5 years ago, the price was somewhere different than it was now, right? Because it was a niche. It's not, of course, there are market dynamics and supply and demand and whatnot, but it's also that production of these highly expensive research products is tough because you have a small market and it's labor intensive and no good technology because there's no reason to develop a good technology because the market is so small. I think what you brought up there initially, that interesting thought on pharma, is absolutely correct, is that if you can convince somebody that activin A can turn into a major business 50 years from now or 20, let's say 10 years from now,
right,
then production of that resource will become interesting and a lot cheaper suddenly. I mean, like you said, I don't think that regenerative medicine will be something sort of an elitary treatment that is only available to the few. I think if we develop something that works, we'll manage to. I mean, I trust our global society in some ways that we'll find ways and understand that we want to distribute this.
I think so. I think everybody in transplantation and everybody with exposure to the field is at least subconsciously aware that we're only serving 10% of the people who actually need this resource.
Right.
And it's so exciting to think that there's a way out there to actually go to serving everybody, that it just seems like everything should be sort of mobilized to make that happen. Sabrina, do you want? No. Okay. So, yeah. Okay.
Hi, Dr. Ed.
Yeah.
So, I'm also a student of Dr. Soles's. However, I don't possess any formal medical education. But I've worked enough with Dr. Soles to be a little familiar with this topic, and from all the literature that I've read about regenerative kidneys, it seems that the kidney is like really the, I guess, holy grail of regenerative organs, just because of the complexity of what's inside it, right? And my question to you is, when you're seeding these scaffolds, how are you guys ensuring that the cells that make for example, the leukohemoglobin, how can you ensure that those cells end up in the right place? Because with all the literature that I've read, it seems that they just kind of put the cells in and the cells have kind of like a mind of their own and they just happen to turn into the correct system.
No, I think that's the key question, right? So both actually kidney and lung have the same issue, that you have a relatively large epithelial compartment that needs to be seeded with a site-specific phenotype, and we just we haven't figured that part out yet. The question is, how much of it do we need to figure out? So what we saw in kidney reseeding was that glomerular epithelial cells tended to stuck more to the glomerulus, right, podocytes, and think that that is a little bit of a niche effect based on the integrin profile of the glomerular basement membrane. But to say that you know, distal tubular epithelial cells stuck to the distal tubule and proximal tubular epithelial cells stuck to the proximal tubule is not right. I mean, the issue is that we see that a mix of tubular epithelial cells onto the loop of Henle as a whole, basically, and whatever stuck and did not get to the point where we're able to distinguish the formation of proximal versus distal tubule. The question is really from a device perspective, how much do we need, right? How much of a functional nephron do we need to regenerate to get somebody off hemodialysis? And basically, an organ would need to be blood perfused. So blood needs to go in, blood needs to come out, and there needs to be filtration somewhere in between. And I think with a completely re-endothelialized glomerulus, we're already relatively close to that. And then the next step is, of course, the myriad of advanced functions that the tubular epithelium of different location fulfills. The question is really, how many of those do we need? If you think of hemodialysis, there's not a single cell in hemodialysis, right? There's two fluids and a membrane in between, and it works okay. It doesn't work great, but it works okay. It keeps people alive for a while. And so I wonder if we can take that approach to say, what are the minimal design criteria for our epithelium? What are the minimal things that this epithelium needs to do? Do we really need concentration, or do we really need active, let's say, bicarbonate production? Or can we get away with less, basically? And I mean, to get back to Dr. Solis's argument from the beginning that there might be synergy with current existing industry, I think that's one of the selling points, right? Where you say, well, you're looking at somebody with a whole different animal of end-stage renal disease. You know, you're somebody who can get rid of fluid but cannot control his salt metabolism well, or cannot produce erythropoietin, for example, or cannot do X, Y, and Z. And so that person becomes suddenly a surviving customer for you, or pharmaceutical industry in that sense, with an imperfect organ. There's a winded response to your question that we don't have a good method yet to get the right epithelial cell in the right location, absolutely. And I think to believe that it will all magically happen is wishful thinking. I don't necessarily think so. Because the phenomenon of structure formation from scratch is highly complicated, right? And temporal spatial control, growth factors, etc., that we just cannot replicate at this point.
In terms of your trials, has there been anything that you guys have noticed that you can get away with?
So we haven't done enough large animal trials yet in terms of transplanting regenerated constructs to see how their long-term functionals. What we've been working on for the most part was to regenerate an iPS-derived vascular system over the last 3 years that can support a blood-perfused graft for a longer period of time. So we're still at that stage.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So I've been thinking about the kind of big data aspects of this, that if you take a decellularized organ, and if it works pretty well as something you can seed and generate a tissue engineering organ from, if you could somehow simulate that, if you could figure out every parameter of the very complex shape and so on, and fabricated it, then you could make you wouldn't have to have a source of these organs to be decellularized. You could just make them, you know, synthetically from that first template. Are the number of parameters there beyond what a, you know, machine could ever handle? I don't think so. I mean, once we figured out what we know about what extracellular matrix components need to be there, everything that's known about what a successful template is, then we could just re produce that rather than having to find an actual organ to flush the cells out of. Do you think that that's a possible way in which this would work in the future, or are we always going to need a sort of biological source for the organ that we're going to put the cells into?
No, I think, I mean, the only correct answer to that must be no, right? We're not going to always need, because,
right.
I mean, seeing how technology evolves, we'll figure it out at some point. I think right now it's just tremendously hard, and that's when I came from cell therapy and wanted to do a little tissue engineering, basically, that's, I used to inject muscle cells into the heart. That was my job and, mm-hmm. and my interest, and I realized it's not really going to regenerate functional heart muscle, simply because the structural impact of that injury of a heart attack is too big. And so I went to tissue engineering, and there wasn't a good way of creating scaffolds at the time. I mean, there was electrospinning, and 3D printing wasn't around. I mean, it was invented, but stereolithography was invented, but wasn't really applied to tissue engineering yet. But there are techniques techniques of synthesizing a matrix. It's just that they weren't there yet, and I think that's still where this is.
Right.
If you look at the alveolar basement membrane, you're looking at a collagen, elastic fiber collagen membrane that is less than a micron thick, right? Mm-hmm. And that at a three-dimensional complexity and density of vascular channels and interconnectivity, that's just hard to replicate with current technique.
Yes.
And I think that, taking a pig lung or a pig heart or a pig kidney and perfusing it with detergent is a very simple and cheap thing to do. The pig costs you $300, and the mm-hmm. kidney explant time is 30 minutes on a clean table, and right. the perfusates overall cost you maybe $200-$300, and so you have a decellularized scaffold that is the ultimate platform for under $1,000 for a human size organ,
mm-hmm.
versus creating the complexity of this tremendous complexity on a human scale will be very time consuming in a very sophisticated machine.
Yes.
Require a lot of very complex technology. Not to say that that's not where we should be going and will be going, because of course, what we deal with is the perfect organ, but if from a device perspective, again, we might get away with less complexity, there's an argument to be made to try something less complexible, like a dialysis membrane, for example. So I think that, and that's part of the reason why we do a lot of compositional and architectural analysis of these matrices to say, well, what would be the components that we'd have to put together, right? What would we make this thing out of if we would like to replicate, let's say, a postnatal week one lung or kidney or whatever? It's just that I think it's very complex. So technology, I think, will be there at some point. It's just not there right now. And what we're focusing on are different questions. So we keep using the old platform, basically, because it enables us to understand how to guide cellular morphogenesis and how to direct these later stages of development, while we don't have to worry about matrix. And if somebody comes along and makes an artificial matrix, I think these technologies will apply. We'll be able to apply them to that different scaffold.
Right. Well, as you know, stem cell, that the field of stem cells in general has very positive things, but it also has stem cell hype, where people predict that advancements will be made more rapidly than they
right.
will, and that sort of thing. So without wanting to feed into that problem, I think there's a kind of advocacy within transplantation and renal medicine and probably other fields that needs to be undertaken to give the people in that field the idea that they're not that different from the regenerative medicine folks, and we could use their help. It isn't like that when the AST created the regenerative medicine community of practice, that everybody else could heave a sigh of relief because now they don't need to think about this stuff anymore. That small group of people in that community of practice will just take care of everything, and 10 to 15 years later come back with all the answers, and they don't have to worry about all this silliness about stem cells and so on. But of course, that's not really true, that without the help of the mainstream people in the transplant field, progress is going to be very slow. And if there are few people working in this field, if they're regarded as a real niche field in several senses of the word, then progress is going to be exceedingly slow. So really, I think without telling people this is all going to be there in 5 years, we need to create a kind of excitement about it.
Right.
And a kind of, you know, inclusiveness, so that people feel that their existing skills, particularly what they learned in medical school that they may feel is not all that valuable to them anymore, suddenly these things are important enough, important again. Like, you know, I think of Neil Bricker's intact nephron hypothesis, for instance. It was a big part of one's learning of renal physiology back in the 70s. Suddenly, it's important again when, you know, some tubules have cells, others don't, you know, and how would a kidney configured in this way work? What's the background to help me figure that out? So that the things people learned in school that they may have thought, although they may have, you know, nostalgia for it, that they'd never use the information again, we could actually use the information that they have, the specialized knowledge that they have from the past, to solve some of the questions that we're now facing.
No, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I think the key to this is, and that's always the problem, of course, with forward-looking statements, right?
Right.
Like, if you make too many forward-looking statements, everybody eventually says, well, you're a lunatic, and you're just trying to get PR and trying to get attention for something that's never going to work. But the benefit of it is that you show people a platform. Instead of being the lunatic out in the garden, you basically legitimize the effort.
Right? Yes.
You legitimize the topic of organ regeneration in the way that they can apply their skill set to it and help advance it. Because that's what's fascinating about my lab, the research I think in my lab that I find fascinating when I walk into it, because I'm a thoracic surgeon, right?
Mm-hmm.
But there's people who are developmental biologists, stem cell biologists, physiologists, bioengineers who work together and apply themselves to this crazy topic of the, you know, the lunatic out in the garden trying to make the organ regeneration happen. That I think the effort to explain to people that this is something, because of its potential impact, is worthwhile pursuing, will help us pulling in these different disciplines. For example, with lung, the lung paper at the time, Ewald Weibel was one of the people who helped me. He's a pathologist who really quantified how many alveoli are in the human lung. You know, he used to work in the States, then went back to Switzerland. His lung retired, but you know, I came across one of his chapters and sent him an email and said, can you help me? You know, I'm looking at this completely acellular lung now. Can you help me characterize that? Or another example is that there are papers from the 70s looking at freezing injury in rat kidneys and how re-epithelialization occurs and how it's interesting that it occurs if you freeze but not if you burn, right? Well, it makes a lot of sense. I mean, freezing is nothing but decellularization.
Yeah.
So, interesting that you mentioned that. That I think there's a lot of disciplines that need to apply themselves to this kind of research, and it's our job to convince them that it's not completely crazy.
Yeah. Well, let me tell you some of the pitches that I make, particularly surrounding your research. So I go into a room with my, you know, a computer and a PowerPoint and so on, and I show the Nature video first, and then I ask them to imagine a world where the person doing the most interesting kidney research is actually not trained in kidney medicine primarily. Can they imagine this? And of course, all these kidney physicians sitting around, and they realize this is what they just, you know, experience, that whatever they're doing is less exciting than what they've seen in the video, but they've spent substantial portions of their life learning nothing else beyond the kidney, and you probably haven't. So I think that's bound to be stimulating for them, because if you look at the converse of that, you know, how could somebody who actually knows about other parts of the thorax and knows about the heart and the lung and so on do such interesting work? Well, doesn't it mean that they could help you succeed faster? And I think it obviously does, you know?
Right.
If they've been spending their entire career focusing only on the kidney, if you're trying to make a stem cell generated kidney work, these are the people who could help that effort succeed more quickly. And it would be satisfying for them and for you, and the same argument works with, you know, every other specialized organ. And it seems to me that looking upon any part of this as a threat sort of does a disservice to the patient, right? Because if we're only serving 10% of the patients, we're talking about serving 100% of the patients. Any perceived threat going from 10% to 100% is counterbalanced by the amount of good we're doing for the human race by scaling things up like that, you know?
Right, and it's also, I think it's a development, it's in one way it's a platform to develop a clinical tool from technologies that might otherwise not necessarily have enabled that, right?
Yes.
Say, you know, tubular regeneration based on cells or you know, looking at interstitial cells. I mean, a lot of these research areas, one could apply to this platform to translate their knowledge into a clinical application. But also, I think this platform could be an interesting development field for them, mm-hmm. right? I mean, it is a test bed where you can look at cell potential, you can look at the tissue formation, you can look at cell-cell interaction in a very controlled and isolated fashion. So that collaboration not only or that cross-pollination is not only interesting because it applies their science to our problem, but it potentially helps other areas to make new discoveries, right? Like look at the potential, for example, in lung, we look at the regenerative potential of basal cells that mm-hmm. have been a big topic in a bunch of Nature papers last year. And we're looking at how these cells, human cells, actually do engraft and regenerate airway and villi epithelium, or do they not? And this versus the mouse models enables you to really take human basal cells and put them on an empty basement membrane and see if they do it or don't. You know, it's mm-hmm. a very clean model. I mean, if there's no surfactant producing cell, well, there was no distal differentiation there. So I think it's a model system in itself that can be applied to many, many different areas, and unfortunately not everybody sees it that way.
Yeah, but there's some intrinsically exciting things, I think. You know, if you think even about, you know, exciting young people about this, say going into high schools, you know, stuff like that, like the color change. You take an organ, you decellularize it and it turns white, and you put in stem cells and it turns pink again, and then maybe it starts to function and so on. But I think what they could also understand is another way to turn it pink is to just infuse one kind of cell, right? One kind of completely differentiated cell, and will still turn pink, but it won't work because those organs are not going to function with just one kind. So there's a whole lot of, you know, complexity that at the macroscopic level you don't really, you know, appreciate, where suddenly the microscopic milieu becomes very important, but you can't get too hung up on needing to reproduce normal structure 100%, because obviously every organ will work probably with some figure, whatever it is, I don't know, 79% reproduced, you know, original cell configuration or something, or 50% or something. We'll end up finding out. And it will be exciting, actually, to see how well organs that we know have those anatomical defects, how well they actually function. You know, I think that's part of the exciting thing.
It's important to keep an open mind there, right? I mean, who would ever have thought that you don't need pulsatile blood flow to survive?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the first, you know, the thoracic extracorporeal ventricles, they pumped blood in a pulsatile fashion because that's what, one, it was easier, I think, to build the pump that way, but maybe it was, but it was also thought, I think, that pulsatility matters a lot. And then the first, you know, left ventricular assist devices came out without any pulsatile flow. And, you know, you have side effects from it, but you survive with it. So it's interesting, like you say, to find out how much complexity do we need and what is actually required to, because what we're up against is, I mean, the bar is not all that high, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Hemodialysis or you know, ventricular support or extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. I mean, those are non-physiologic replacements. So.
Yeah. Well, I want to thank you very much for taking part in this session today. I look forward to doing it again. I think the field is moving rapidly enough that every time it'll be a little bit different, and your feelings and my feelings about things will shift it a little bit by, you know, whatever's gone on in the intervening 6 months. I should tell you something about video quality for reasons having to do with big fiscal questions here at the university. We used to employ 14 full-time videographers, and they were really good, and I knew them all, and they supported this course. And currently, there are only four. In the entire university, there are only four of them left because they've fired the other 10. So you'll find, and it's not your fault or our fault, that the quality of the video from today is not quite as good as the best of some of the previous ones, because we have, you know, amateurs like me actually putting the pieces of it, you know, together. So I just wanted you to understand that. But I think that's a cyclical phenomenon. Firing videographers is a somewhat biological process in the history of mankind, and there'll come a time when the university will decide that they need to hire a lot of new videographers, because now nobody knows about what's going on at the university because we can't produce any high quality videos any longer. So that's just this kind of semi, you know, amusing sidelight of this, that you'll find that some of the previous videos from this course, if you ever watch them, are very high quality. I'm sure they will be in the future. But of course, the basic thing about video quality has to do with content. And through your efforts today, the content was very good. So
thank you very much. Well, thanks for having me.
So even if you find that the, you know, technical quality isn't quite as high as some of our previous ones, now you know why. So,
I'm sure it's
going to
be perfect.
So anyway, thank you very, very much, and we look forward to you doing this again in the winter term of 2016 and on. So we teach this both terms, and we plan to keep on forever, whatever that means in this case. So.
It's a pleasure being part of this. Thank you so much.
Okay, great. And I'll stay in touch, and thank you.
Please do.
Okay, thank you very, very much.
And thank you.
Bye-bye. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So any questions for me?
He just funds himself.
What?
He just funds himself at the university. There's a funding issue here, isn't there?
Well, no. He's done well.
Yeah.
He's done well because the NIH has these special initiatives for regenerative medicine, and so he is in charge of one of them, And, you know, Harvard's a very good place, and so he's able to interact with a lot of other good people there and so on. So I think he isn't suffering, but the whole field is sort of suffering that it's not better funded than
well,
it
that's
is.
That's what he said. He said we need to do much more research done.
Yeah.
He's okay, but
he's
one of the few people who's doing it, right?
Yes, yes.
And you.
Yeah. So really, we've spoken to the main people. Those are the main sort of household words. Those two guys, you know, they say regenerative medicine, kidney. Yeah, there's Jason Wertheim and Harald Ott. Those are the two names that they would come up with, you know. And so, yeah, there are other people in the field, but those are the two best known. And so, yeah, the field needs to be much better funded. But rather than just whining and complaining about that, I mean, I think like the quality of what we discuss here can actually make a change in that. People watch the videos and are completely unconvinced by, you know, by the arguments that we make, then that does less good for the field than if people watch them and say, wow, you know, I really want to put my money in this technology.
It's a long-term money thing is one of the issues.
Yeah.
And then he made that clear. He didn't hype it up and lie or anything. He's just absolutely honest.
Yes,
but,
yes.
Immensely important.
Yeah. There's a question. So the media hype here, you know, is it like criminal wrongdoing? I don't think so, right? It's just journalists doing their job and trying to write something that's quite readable and that people spend a lot of time reading and that does their paper or their website. So there's a natural tendency to make things sound better and more exciting.
No kidding. How about physics at CERN, for example? Lots of hype there too.
Yes.
Lots of science hype everywhere.
Yeah. So I think that really becomes the fine line that I think he's walking and I am too, to try to be a strong, you know, advocate for this, while not going beyond to actually telling people things that aren't true, that in 5 years all medicine is going to be, you know, regenerative medicine, and, you know, that this will all happen and the world is just going to be transformed overnight. On the other hand, the change this is going to bring about is going to be absolutely tremendous. So when it happens, it's going to be one of the biggest deals ever, you know. So, and although we don't know when it's going to occur, I mean, if you compare the technological singularity to this, this is much more certain to happen. This, we're already on the route to, and we know for sure, you know, this is going to happen. So it's more tangible, practical, and more happening in the short term than some other things that we talk about in this course.
So we normally use the simple organs, right?
Yeah, yes, yeah. Yeah, it is, and it's really interesting. The problems of those simple organs have, like there's one of the first tracheas was put in, functioned well for, I don't know, 8 months, and then just sort of collapsed at a certain point because, you know, there's blood flow from the top, blood flow from the bottom, and you end up with a sort of watershed region that's not receiving very good flow from either side. And so the cells don't survive fairly, very well there. And I think that's why it happened to, you know, collapse at that point.
Well, it's amazing it works at all to me. I wouldn't have dreamt that it would work. I mean, it's like the cells do know where to go. How do they know that?
Well, but what you're sensing is also another, so non-biology trained people, like the physicists involved in making the filters, develop a kind of magical belief about biology and what it can do.
Yeah.
That it's true that if you look at normal embryogenesis or what happens in a, you know, developing fetus or whatever, it's like amazing. But that's because over millions of years, like all those processes have been optimized so that we end up with a successful biological offspring, right? So here we're sort of messing with all those parameters. The time frame's different, the milieu's different, the relationships, you know, spatially and so on. So everything's changed, and that's not been optimized, right? So, so you know, it's
left over from embryogenesis.
Yes, yes. Really. We're just hoping. And so the physicists, the pure physicists who make the filter and look all starry-eyed about biology and cells knowing exactly where to go and what to differentiate into, it's not quite as as easy as that.
So that's why, for example, with the bone marrow, it works better because it's, well, why does that work better?
Because it's not localized. This is something circulating in the whole body.
But it's simpler in some way.
Yeah.
It, you don't need a special place to go. Or
yeah, and you don't need to worry about oxygenation and circulatory support because it's in the blood, right?
There's only one thing happening, basically.
Yeah.
Transmission into the proper bone marrow cells.
Yeah.
To make blood.
Yeah.
There's
yeah.
just one thing going on. Not yeah. like in a kidney where I don't know how many different cells there
yeah.
are.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, it's a much simpler thing, and a lot of the challenges that exist in solid organ transplantation just don't, you know, exist there.
So the next thing to do is the simplest organ, which is?
Well, I don't know. I mean, like, it seems like even like trachea, you know, esophagus are
that's pretty simple.
Yeah, those are pretty simple, but they're, yeah.
But it doesn't get anything in the middle of it. Well, it's not as good
still
in the middle.
Not good in the middle.
It's still not perfect.